Would a loving God send anyone to an everlasting hell? That is the question, and that is the message that I have for you today. By the way, the answer to that question is absolutely yes. So let's dig into the Word of God, ladies and gentlemen, going to the book of Luke to begin. Luke chapter 16, let's look at verse 19. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water, and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Oh my, what a powerful passage of scripture we have here, folks. Keep in mind that it was Jesus Christ who was speaking. This is the King of Kings. This is the Lord of Lords. This is the I Am. This is the first and the last, folks, that was speaking this message to the people. I do not belong to the crowd of people, by the way, who take this as a parable. I believe this is speaking of a real event that happened. Okay, because why do I say that? Because you don't see, if you look at all the other parables, you will never find the Lord addressing people by their name, by their actual name. And he uses names here, Lazarus and Father Abraham. So I believe this was an actual event, not a parable, as most people would believe today. So let's take a closer look at this passage. We see, first of all, that the rich man, okay, he lived an extravagant lifestyle. The scriptures make it clear that he fared sumptuously every day. You know, I don't believe this guy was eating hamburgers from Mickey D's or White Castle. This man lived the life of Riley, as they would say. He had plenty of money. On the other hand, you have Lazarus. He was a beggar. He was outside with the dogs, okay? It says the dogs came and licked his sores. This man was in big trouble, you know? Big trouble. He didn't have any money. He was with the dogs. More than likely, they were throwing food, the scraps, to the dogs, and he was eating from the same scraps that the dogs were, because he was right there with the dog. So it's what a contrast we have here. So we have the rich and we have the poor. And this is a very important teaching that the Lord wants to get through to us. So we see the scene changes, and we find that this man, Lazarus, the beggar, the scripture tells us in verse 22, the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. And it says the rich man also died and was buried. Verse 23, and in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and he seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. What a contrast we have in this teaching here, folks. The rich man went to hell. The rich man went to hell. And look at where we find the beggar. He's in the bosom of Abraham. You know, some people have a teaching that this is called Abraham's bosom. No, he was leaning on the bosom, into the bosom of Abraham, known as the father of the faithful, the father of believers. I used to sing this song, if you remember, the young kids would sing that song. Father Abraham has many sons has Father Abraham. I am one of them, and so are you. So let's just praise the Lord. You remember that song. So Father Abraham, folks, this is what it's about. If you look in John 13, 23, you'll find one of the disciples leaning on Jesus's bosom. This is how they would eat together. You know, they would recline, not like we do today. You go to a restaurant, you pull up your chair. So it was different back in those days. So I want you to see that, folks. So what we learn here is that Lazarus had a relationship with God. He was saved. He was with the Lord. This is incredible, folks. Lazarus was a saved man. Now, if you would see him outside there eating the scraps by the dogs and they're licking the sores, you would feel sorry for him. And naturally, that's a natural thing to do. You see this man suffering. But most people wouldn't think of this man, if he dies, you know, going into glory. But that's just what happened. And here we have the rich man went to hell. So that's another thing. That's the only thing that matters, ladies and gentlemen. Something else you need to realize, folks, that hell is forever. Hell is a place of everlasting torment. You know, there are many false teachings out there, folks. You know, many people believe that you're annihilated after you die, that you cease to exist. I'm here to tell you today that is a false teaching. You know, many different beliefs out there. The Watchtower Society, they don't believe in an eternal hell. But it's funny, I used to have I made a point of getting one of their Bibles, and one of their Bibles, I think it was from 1971, of that New World Translation, they did have a teaching on hell right in the Bible. I didn't save it. I wish I did. But so it's incredible. But they do not believe. I think they teach annihilation. I know the SDA, that's the Seventh-day Adventist, the Ellen White crowd, they don't believe in eternal hell, everlasting torment. They cannot reconcile a loving God with people in hell. They can't comprehend it. But keep in mind, folks, this is Jesus Christ who is doing the talking. He's the creator of all things. In fact, he created hell too. So this is deity speaking, the Alpha and Omega, folks. And it's very important. You see that I'm going to prove that to you right now. Look at Matthew chapter 25. And this is when the Lord is talking about the judgment. He talks about the sheep and the goats. Okay, those on the right hand and those on the left hand. So the sheep are on the right and the goats are on the left. Listen to what Jesus said here. Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. So this is the judgment of God. This is real people being cast into everlasting fire. The word there, ladies and gentlemen, for everlasting, it's spelled this way, A-I-O-N-I-O-S, Aionios, okay? Aionios, don't forget that. The word for everlasting. Don't miss this. Now, I'm going to go to Matthew 25, verse 46. He's speaking still of those who are being damned. And it says, and these shall go away into everlasting punishment. Okay. The word for everlasting there, once again, is that Greek word, aionios. Everlasting means perpetual. Doesn't end. It does not end. Don't miss this. But the righteous, now he's speaking about the righteous, those who are on the right hand, but the righteous into life eternal. The word for eternal there, folks, is the exact same word in the Greek, aionios. So here, what am I trying to say here? You can't have it both ways. If you believe in everlasting life, aionios, then you must also believe in everlasting punishment, because the same exact word is being used. You can't just trash one and say, well, this can't be, but I'll take everlasting life. This is what people do with the scriptures. They twist the scriptures to make it easier for them to receive. They don't want to be troubled by this teaching, but this is the teaching that was given by Almighty God. This was the teaching that was given by Jesus Christ himself. He said it, it's true, folks. So you can't have it both ways. Don't forget that. Remember those scriptures, Matthew 25:41 and Matthew 25:46. Remember the word for everlasting and the word for eternal. Same word, aionios. So torment, punishment, it is forever. Don't listen to the crowd that tries to sway you and say you're annihilated, everything's okay. You know, listen to me now. There are people who commit suicide that think that things are going to be over. They do not understand that they are jumping into hell, folks. I'm telling you, these teachings that are out there today, they're wicked and they're false. The most loving thing you can do, folks, is give people the truth about the gospel, the true gospel. This is what the stewardship of the gospel is all about. When you hold back the truth like this, you're actually doing people a great disservice. You're soft-soaping the word of God. You're sugarcoating the word of God to please people. Don't ever forget that. So remember, can't have it both ways, folks. Another thing you need to know, there is no second chance, folks. After you die, you know, I said it many times. I'm a former Roman Catholic. We had a teaching known as purgatory. You've heard that word before, but maybe you didn't understand it. You know, people teaching is they believe you gonna go be purged. Okay, sometimes it's referred to God's hospital. I think that was the St. Joseph Baltimore Catechism. In other words, you'll be purged before you're ready for heaven. No such place, folks. In fact, Roman Catholic Church, they will have masses offered up, the sacrifice of the mass, where they believe that the justice of God is satisfied at that mass. And they will have masses offered up for dead people. People have been dead for decades, praying them out of purgatory. And I'm not making this up, folks. That is the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church. So they teach that, folks. There is no purgatory. You know, many people believe, you know, in Roman Catholicism, there's something known as the Sabbatine privilege. And it all has to do with this a brown scapula, that they believe if they're wearing this scapula, that Mother Mary, the Mother of God, which they teach, is going to pluck them out of purgatory. That's what they believe. They believe Mary's going to do this, and especially on Saturdays, that's when she's going to take them out if they're found wearing this brown scapula. I'll put an image up on a screen, folks, and you'll see that this scapula, by the way, you know, when you look at these images, you'll always see, as I've said many times before, Big Mary, little Jesus, a little goo-goo infant, goo-goo baby, being held by Mother Mary. Another deception, right from the pit of hell, by the way. Folks, this is all Roman Catholic tradition. And people are led to believe that if they wear that scapula, that brown scapula, that they're going to be okay. And many people to this day will wear that scapula. In fact, that Sabbatine privilege, it actually came about, the Sabbatine privilege from a papal bull from March 3rd, 1322, attributed to Pope John the 22nd. In this bull, the Pope declared that the Mother of God had appeared to him, most urgently recommended to him the Carmelite order, and its members revealed the Sabbatine privilege and asked that he reveal and ratify it before the world. Folks, this is spacey stuff. This is demonic stuff here. And you see, this is the way the devil works, folks. In fact, the devil does not want you to hear what I'm telling you today. I'm giving you the truth here. And at the end of this message, folks, I hope you listen. I mean, we're talking about your soul. We're talking about eternity. I'm going to tell you how you can avoid going to this place called hell, okay? So keep in mind, folks, I believe stuff like this. I didn't wear a brown scapula, but you know, I did wear what's known as a green scapula. The brown scapula, I think it had two parts to it. The green scapula, it was just one little, like, cardboard thing you'd wear it around your neck. Sometimes it would rub against my chest and irritate me, so I took it off and carried it in my wallet. But basically, it was a prayer, the Immaculate Heart of Mary, pray for us now. and at the hour of our death. So that, you know, there are many little trinkets like this. This is all superstition, okay? And probably many of you who are listening now, you can relate to what I am telling you. So I want you to know, folks, the truth about this place called hell. People are conscious in hell. Don't ever forget that. People are conscious in hell. Very important for you to know that. So the rich man, keep in mind in that story from Luke 16, he was fully conscious and he immediately recognized Abraham and he called him Father Abraham, okay? Called him. That's what he called him. And the man obviously thought he was right with God before he died, but then he found that he wasn't. Listen to what we have here in John chapter 8, verses 37 to 42. Jesus Christ speaking to his own Jewish people. He says, I know that ye are Abraham's seed or descendant, but ye seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I've seen with my father, and ye do that which you have seen with your father. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus saith unto them, if ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, ye would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God, neither came I of myself, but he sent me. That's powerful, folks. What I want you to see here is that his own people were telling him, Jesus, that Abraham was their father. So do you see the rich man that went to hell, he immediately addressed Abraham as Father Abraham. Don't miss that, folks. Many people think that God is their father, but he's not. We're talking salvation here. We're talking eternity. We're talking how you can go to heaven and avoid this place called hell. I'm giving you the greatest news you could ever hear in your lifetime, folks. Glory to God. So that's what I want you to see, folks, as far as that goes. And you can see, let's read another passage here, Matthew chapter 3, verses 7 and 9. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, this is speaking of John the Baptist, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits, meet or worthy for repentance, and think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. So look at what John the Baptist said. He was speaking along the same lines as Jesus Christ. He said, don't go saying Abraham is our father. Once again, they were relying on their heritage. Abraham's our father. They rejected Christ. They rejected the message of John the Baptist. And so John the Baptist was not impressed, folks, with the religious lineage of the Jewish people. He made that very clear. Let's go, and we see that people are also in torment in hell. Okay? Look at that. The rich man, he made a passionate plea to Father Abraham for mercy. He requested that Abraham would send Lazarus with just a drop of water on his finger to cool his tongue. Wow, that's powerful, folks. Keep in mind, Jesus Christ is not trying to scare people. He's telling the truth here. He's not trying to tease people, but he's telling the truth. This man asked for a drop of water. Think about this. This was the same man who fared sumptuously every day. And in an instant, he's now begging for a drop of water on his tongue. You know, for people to turn around and say, oh, no, that's not what it means. Oh, no. Oh, hell is the, we're annihilated. Would a loving God send anybody to hell? Don't give me this fire and brimstone stuff. I don't want to hear it. I've heard stuff like this, folks. But here, think about this. The one who's telling a story, folks, is the most compassionate man to ever walk the face of this earth, the most loving person that ever walked the face of this earth, that he would go to the cross, die for our sins. He's the same one who said these things, folks. These are not my words. And he's shouting out a warning for a reason. And that's what I'm bringing forth to you today. This is the gospel, folks. This is the other side that you never hear. You know, people love to hear God is love. God is love. Yes, he is. But here's the other side. You see, when you talk about sins and separation from God, you talk about the sacrifice of Christ, you talk about heaven, you can't leave out hell. You know, many people sometimes will refer to hell as a Christless eternity. You see, it's a little easier to say those words. It's hell, okay? So don't forget that. So we see that he was calling upon Father Abraham. Hell is a real place. It is a place that is forever. You know, I've heard it all. Well, I shouldn't say that. I've heard many things, you know, laughers and mockers and people mock hell, you know. I want to go to hell. That's where all my friends are going to be. They laugh about it. Yeah. Well, you will not be laughing. You will not be mocking in hell, folks. Don't ever forget that. So as far as the rich man went, folks, the party was over. That was it. The party was over. In an instant, he was taken to this place. We saw there, folks, it was a great gulf fixed. He could not go from one side to the other, and they made that very, very clear to that man. Oh, the horror. Think about the horror, knowing that there's no way out of hell, folks. Think about that. So, and keep in mind that Jesus Christ is the one who spoke these things. The rich man then begged Father Abraham to send Lazarus to testify to his five brothers. Now think about this. There came a point when the rich man in hell realized he was not getting out. And his brothers came to mind. And he said, go send Lazarus to warn them, to testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. That's what the scriptures say. That's what Jesus said. What did Abraham say when the rich man made that request? He said, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. It's in verse 29. What was he saying? He was saying, they have the scriptures. We could say today, you have the Bible. You have the word of God. There'll be no excuses. You have the scriptures. So this man's brothers, his five brothers, Abraham said, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. That's powerful, folks. What a day it's going to be for the gospel mockers when they realize their own foolish heart was darkened by their own rebellion and sin. Romans chapter 1, verses 20 to 22. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Oh my, oh my. So the rich man, he was concerned for his five brothers. It's almost like he became an evangelist in hell. And he was hoping that Lazarus could somehow go and warn his five brothers. This was the man who was outside the gate of the rich man. He probably had his five brothers over the house. Or maybe they all lived together. It doesn't really tell us. But maybe he figured if Lazarus went there, it would be a good shaking. But that's not what happened. And Abraham basically said, look, they have the prophets, Moses and the prophets. If they don't hear them, they wouldn't believe it if a guy rose from the dead. Think about that. That shows you the power in the word of God. that he would say something like that. We have the scriptures, folks. You have the word of God available to you today. That's why there'll be no excuse at all. So what does the Bible say? Mark 8, 36 and 37. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? You could be the richest man in the world, folks. You cannot buy salvation. Salvation is not for sale. So when a person dies, folks, everything you own, it'll be right where you left it. The television sets, the DVD players, your cell phone, your iPhone, whatever it is, it'll be right where it was. Your car in your driveway, it'll be right there. But where will you be? Where will you be? So that's the question I put to you today. Remember this, James 4:14. Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. So folks, that's the message for you today. Keep in mind that hell is forever. I showed you that earlier, the word aionios. But now I'm going to tell you how to avoid this place with one of my favorite passages of scripture. Don't ever forget this, folks. In fact, memorize it. Romans chapter 5, verses 6 to 10. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure, or perhaps for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. That's the greatest thing you could ever hear, folks. Christ died for the ungodly. Folks, without Christ, you're ungodly. I was on my way to hell. You've heard me say this many times. I was ungodly on my way to hell. Just like you. Irish, my wife is Italian, used to go to my in-laws, have meatballs, spaghetti, sausage, the whole nine yards, the raviolis. I mean, just a regular person, folks. And I'm here to tell you today, I got saved, okay? I did all of these religious things, but I was on my way to hell. I was lost. Don't forget this, folks. God commended or demonstrated his love toward us. See where it says us? Put your name there. Put your name there. God commended his love toward us, Mary, John, Charlie, okay? In that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Folks, if you remember one thing from this message, there's only one thing that will justify you before Almighty God on Judgment Day. Don't ever forget this. It's the blood that Christ shed on the cross. He did it for you. He did it for you, okay? It's not reading some creed, folks, that's going to get you into heaven. It's you calling upon the Lord, knowing that he did that for you. We're talking salvation, okay? And this is how you're saved from wrath. I'm talking about the wrath of God. Without Christ, the wrath of God is upon you right now. Look at John 3:36. Look it up for yourself. John chapter 3, verse 36. Romans 5:10. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. I used to be an enemy of God, but then I was reconciled to God. Folks, I searched for the truth. For years, I did not know the Lord Jesus Christ, especially in the 70s, even in the 80s. I used to go out to a mall on Long Island, Roosevelt Field Mall. I used to go to a bookstore, looking through these books in the self-improvement, the religious, the spiritual. I was hungry. But it wasn't for many years that I came right back to the book of books. Glory to God. The Bible, folks. B-I-B-L-E. Basic instructions before leaving earth. Glory to God. I heard a preacher say once, I believe the Bible from cover to cover. I even believe the cover. Glory to God. So let me end it here, folks. Look at this verse, Romans 10:13. Don't forget this. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I'm going to read it again. For whosoever, see where it says whosoever? Put your name there. Your first name, your last, both. It doesn't make any difference. For whosoever, for John Doe shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Here's the deal, folks. You call upon the Lord from your heart. Stop what you're doing right now. Look, you know, there's something in you. You know I'm telling you the truth. You've been searching. You wake up in the morning. There's this big hole, this emptiness. You say, what's this life all about? Especially now. I mean, this COVID-19, incredible stuff going on. And maybe the Lord's, you're starting to think about your life more seriously. Where will I go after I die? Well, I'm giving you the best information. I'm trying to save you years of trouble, years of torment like I went through searching for the truth. I'm giving it to you right here in a nutshell. Call upon the Lord. Say, Lord, save me. You don't have a Bible? Get one. I prefer the King James, okay? Get yourself a Bible. In fact, hopefully soon I'll do a teaching on some good advice on how to get a Bible. So that's it, folks. You know, I'm here to tell you today I love you in the Lord. I want you to hear the truth here today, folks. There is a hell. And when you come to Christ, when you realize, folks, when I read about hell, it just makes me more appreciative of Christ, of Jesus Christ. I said, Lord, what you rescued me from. I mean, you know, I was hanging by a thread, folks. I thought, you know, what you do when you get saved, you say, wow. You think of all the times, you say, well, I could have died here. And you say, whoa. You know, that's, you start thinking, you could die today. This could be your last moment, you know. So don't forget what I just told you, folks. And I want you to be blessed in the Lord Jesus Christ today.